So are data breaches inevitable?
It is increasingly difficult to prevent bad things from happening. And so, you know, I have always advised businesses that I work with to focus on one word, and that word is resilience, right? At the end of the day, you need to plan for the full range of threats. It goes back to our imagination piece. Imagine the best, but imagine the worst of what could happen. Plan for it, prepare for it, be able to practice responding to it, practice recovering from it. That's why some of those tabletop exercises are so important. To include, you know, when you talk about what you do from an AI governance perspective, those incident response drills are incredibly important as well. Think about something bad happening because you've given too many permissions to an agent on your network, right? You haven't done the basics about thinking about, you know, agents as features versus agents as actual identities, because that's what they are. So thinking about all the things that can potentially go wrong, and then thinking about what you can do to get ahead of a bad thing happening. And, you know, by the way, one of the things that I talk about when breaches happen, like the most important thing is transparency and communications. And that's not often what comes to mind right away. You're like, oh, we've got to tell the general counsel who's going to have to tell the regulators or whatever if you're a public company. But the most important thing, I think, when a breach happens is to be transparent about what you tell your clients and customers to maintain that trust.
Agentic AI came out. It's an unbelievable tool. It's very powerful. But in the hands of bad actors, nation states, or even just, you know, anybody really can write an agent to do something. What is the scariest thing? Have you seen anything that was like, oh, I'm going to think about this when I go to bed tonight? And I'm like, this is terrifying now that we have agents, now that these people who are bad actors have these agents.
There are a lot of really scary things out there that can be done to turbocharge attackers, whether it's highly, highly tailored spear phishing emails that anybody will click on, even somebody who has been doing cyber for a really long time, or very stealthy malware that's very, very hard to detect and prevent. Certainly, there are capabilities that have to do with deep fakes and disinformation. If you just look at some of the big news over the past couple of weeks, some of the campaigns out of China that have to do with infiltrating our telecommunications networks for espionage. What I always worried about the most when I was at CISA, and this is something we discovered a couple years ago, but you can think about how these capabilities could really be turbocharged, was we had discovered Chinese hackers from the People's Liberation Army had burrowed deep into our most sensitive critical infrastructure. So think about water and power and telecommunications and transportation. But David, it wasn't to steal our data or to spy on us. It was actually to be able to launch disruptive attacks in the event of a crisis in Taiwan. So this is a world where a war in Asia could, you know, you could see water being unavailable, power systems going down, trains being derailed, comm systems severed, all to essentially incite panic here in the U.S. and deter our ability to marshal military might and citizen will. So now that was a campaign discovered before agentic AI was being used either by defenders or attackers. So you can see how this can really turbocharge some of the very real threats, because you could have agents looking for those holes in the technology. And frankly, a lot of them exist. That China's very sophisticated, but they weren't using very sophisticated techniques to break into our infrastructure. They were taking advantage, again, going back to my secure by design point, of insecure, flawed, defective routers, switches, and firewalls that, oh, by the way, businesses large and small across the country and the world depend upon.
Yeah.
So now think about agents simultaneously, autonomously going after all of these points of edge devices that can then get into our critical infrastructure. So to me, it's less about the spying and the stealing of data. That's obviously a scary thing, but it's more about the destructive and the disruptive power that can really affect the critical services we rely upon, how we get our kids to work, how we get water, how we get gas, you know, at the station, how we get our health care, how we get money from the bank. So it's really the impact of turbocharging attacks against our critical infrastructure that motivates me to ensure that we can actually use these capabilities both to enhance our defenders. But again, goes back to my point about if we get this right, if we can build secure agentic AI to solve the legacy code issue, to help us refactor and transform the decades and decades of rickety tech debt insecure code into much stronger code, that's how we increase the friction on our adversaries. And that's ultimately how we end cybersecurity as we know it. The one thing that I will also say, you know, I think there's been some really positive developments that have happened over the past 6 months. One is around this AI action plan. It's very pro-innovation. It's very pro-US competitive globally, but it does also focus on the CBRN threat, chemical, biological, radiological, nuclear, which is incredibly important. It focuses on the secure by design piece, and it focuses specifically on cybersecurity of critical infrastructure. So a recognition from the most senior levels that this, the security of AI systems, is incredibly important. The other thing has been the focus on being more effective from an offensive perspective, right? Where you are actually focused on holding our cyber adversaries at risk in a way that they are willing to hold us at risk. And so I think that some of the things that are being done from an agentic perspective will, again, give us the capability to inform that offense-defense flywheel that'll enable us to be able to, again, hold our adversaries at risk. So it's not just them coming at us with all of their capabilities.
It's like MAD. Like it's the...
Well, I think you have to have something that a little bit closer to that from a policy perspective. And I know that there's some discussions around that. But as these tools become incredibly powerful, they will be not just the most powerful tech, but they'll inform the most powerful weapons. And so there will have to be some sort of, I think, arms control discussion that happens between the most powerful countries that enable us to keep our population safe.
So what advice do you have for enterprises to secure their attack surface?
It's the same stuff we've sort of been talking about throughout, but let me just break it down pretty simply. Like the most important thing, I think, comes down to leadership and culture, right? Leaders who recognize that cyber risk, technology risk, AI risk is not just a reputational issue, but frankly could be an existential issue for the business. And so at the very senior level, at the CEO and board level, they need to care about these things and signal all the way down how important it is that everybody takes responsibility for keeping business systems and networks and data safe. And from a culture perspective, that everybody needs to have the awareness and the training to understand what the risks are of integrating new capabilities like agentic AI, but just at the end of the day, what their actions could cause from risk to business, right? At the end of the day, whether it's things like not enabling multi-factor authentication, like not having, you know, strong, unique passwords, not keeping your devices updated, you know, oftentimes businesses that suffer cyber attacks and breaches, it's really the simple stuff. I think there's a whole thing in the IBM report about what are the causes of these various breaches. And the number one cause, I think, is phishing. So people who fall for phishing attacks, and with AI, phishing is going to become even more tailored. The only thing I would take issue with is I don't think that's a root cause. I think that's much more a proximate cause. The root cause is always, why was that technology built in such a way that it made it so easy to phish that employee? And so again, it goes back to not only does a business need to have the leadership and culture that mandates the right cybersecurity controls and procedures and governance policy, but also what are we demanding of the technology companies and vendors that we take advantage of to help enhance our business? Are we asking them, what are you doing to ensure that the products that I am using are built as secure as possible?